Hello, everybody. Welcome to Ascension and Astrology. I had to think about that for a second. Where am I now?
Ascension and Astrology.
We're in Ascension and Astrology. I'm Janet HIckox. I'm the astrologer part of that. And this is Kornelia Stephanie, the Ascension part of this. Tell us, what are you? Ascension, you used a great word a while ago.
Ascension guide.
Ascension guide. Oh, hey. We don't have our light on.
Ascension guide.
Ascension guide. I love that.
You know, it's more like way shower, showing the way.
I still like the idea of you being some kind of an alchemist, right? Somebody that creates change. So how's everybody doing out there? I see Tom and I see Vanita. I see you, but I don't, you haven't really checked in yet, but I see you out there. Good to see you with us. We are going to go through some of the things that are happening right now that point us in a direction of transformation and ascension, evolution, etc. So I'm going to turn it over to Kornelia because as the ascension guide, she's going to tell us what's at the dock. What's at the dock? You used that term a few minutes ago. It was so cool. What's at the dock?
So part of what I feel like we're all being asked right now is to cultivate a deeper level of trust, a deeper level of trust, a deeper level of faith, a deeper level of faith and a deeper level of trust, and bring that energy into, you know, this unfolding right now in this uncertainty, because right now, as you know, as the astrologer, you know that the sun just moved into Pisces, right? So the sun just moved into Pisces. And so the water, we're like in water, right?
Yeah.
We're totally in water and we don't have our footing and we are swimming, right? We're swimming.
Swimming. Have you ever watched that show?
No.
Dory, you know, the little fish from, I don't know. You don't have grandkids.
No. So, but you know, just we're in that energy. And so being able to really, again, everything is happening on the inside of our bodies, on the inside of our physical bodies. And because our bodies are made of 80% water. So here we are learning how to, again, develop a deeper level of trust where we are now, because there's just so much unveiling taking place. So much has revealed itself, wouldn't you say, over the last couple of weeks?
Yes,
with this Virgo full moon also.
I would say that, but there's still this element of fire. We were just talking about rebellion, right? Where how we both have been sort of rebelling against different things, but sort of the same kinds of things, and that's very much fire. And then you put us in water, and it almost gets more frustrating because it's like treading water. You know, have you ever tried to swim run, right? You have to completely rearrange the way you do things in the water to get where you want to go. And that's kind of what I'm feeling now too, is that, that slowing down, that, steam being created by fire and water.
Yeah. And again, it's like taking a step back, and what is it really about for you? So rather than reacting, right? Like reacting.
Like I want to?
Yeah. Like reacting, like going off on somebody, taking a step back and really looking at what is it about for you, and knowing that you can't lose, that the only thing you really have to do is just speak your truth and speak your mind. Speak your heart, you know, speak up for yourself, and also trust that what you're saying, that you have a right to stand up for yourself, that you have a right to speak up for yourself, that what you're saying, you're not going to lose by doing so. You know what I mean?
Yes, I do. Easier said than done, though.
It is easier said than done, but that's part of our mastery. That's part of the mastery of work that we're in right now. And, you know, we're up for it. We're up for it. We are up for it. And, you know, this is part of what we're needing.
Yes, it is definitely. So what you're seeing is my own trigger. Today I've been triggered. Yesterday I was triggered. I swear to God, I've been triggered every day since maybe Sunday, maybe Saturday, in some way, shape, or form, whether it was a trigger about my skills or a trigger about me trying to get something done that I can't get done, or feedback on what I've done, or opening up to do something and then, you know, it's not being received. So many different things, you know, that are going on that I'm being triggered about. And that does, you know, I'm just one person. I can't even imagine what our listeners might be being triggered over. Could be in relationships. It could be about abundance and money, jobs, you know, people, situations, you know, just random things that come up. And I was beginning to think, I was beginning to feel like on a very swift rolling swing, you know, like you get at the fairs, right? You know, and it takes you woo to one end of the pendulum and then woo, you're at the other end and then woo, you're back again. Because I think that I can probably say with all honesty that I have been through every emotion almost every day this week.
And so part of what's happening too is so that you can really see where you're still being triggered so that you can move into a neutral place of not being triggered, right?
Yeah.
You and I were experiencing, you know, similar things in that it had to do with our level of expertise and going public with our level of expertise, you with something you're working on and me with something that I'm working on in the media. Right.
Right.
And again, it comes down to that level of trust that, you know, here, you know, you were putting this body of work together and somebody was criticizing it and making it seem like, you know, that this is what you need to say. This is what you need to do. And you now having to stand up for yourself and saying, wait a minute, this is my authentic truth in this, right?
Right.
And not to be triggered by it, not to be angry by it, but that, yeah, this is your truth. And this is, you're going to stand up for yourself.
I want to share what some people are saying here, because, you know, sometimes when we're going through these things, we can feel very alone.
Like, yes.
Like I'm the only one that's being triggered by this or having this issue, but it's so wonderful to come over here and talk to Kornelia and realize that she's going through the same things. And then I'm sitting here reading now what some people are saying, and they're going through similar things. For Angie, it's people forcing their opinions on me, which is a huge trigger. Mm-hmm. Debbie says, me too. Mm-hmm. Rebecca, yes, I can definitely relate to being triggered and feeling held back. And Angie says, I'm being triggered a lot this week. And Tom says, triggered? Tell me about it. Jennifer, me too, triggered. Jacqueline, hi, this is my first Ascension in Astrology have tuned into. Well, welcome, Jacqueline. It's good to see you out there. And so it's good to know that, I mean, isn't it good to know?
It is good to know.
I don't feel so all alone. I don't feel like, you know, I'm up here talking now about something that no one else is experiencing.
Exactly. And yeah, and exactly. So, because we were both rebelling. Janet was rebelling and I was rebelling too. It's just that, you know, what I was rebelling on was literally costing me a lot of money. And I took a step back and it was like, wait a minute, here I am rebelling. I'm not doing anything about it. And again, for me, it was about having that trust that, that I trust my intuitive guidance, that I trust what's coming out of me and that, that I'm going to communicate that. And that was the thing. And the same thing with you.
Yeah.
That your body of work, that you trust that, you know, and for it not to be diminished or, you know, it doesn't need to be edited the way that it was, you know?
Yes, that's true. And then of course you know, you wonder too, like, am I being overly sensitive? Mm-hmm. That came up. That was one of my triggers. What was the word I told you that also came up? I was making myself a piece of toast and I said, oh, prima donna, you're being a prima donna.
I think that's from your childhood. Those are words from your childhood.
Yeah. Like, it's actually written into my human design report.
Is it really?
The word prima donna.
Wow.
And I
mean, you know,
yai.
It's you standing up for yourself.
Right.
Is the thing.
Maybe, I mean, what is a prima donna? I mean, it could be positive, right? It doesn't have to be negative. It could be me standing my ground and saying, okay, but this is how it's going to be.
Yeah.
No prima donna negative there. It's all about, you know, me really taking that and, you know, standing my ground with something. But it's hard. It is hard. Mm-hmm. And I know it's a wound We were going to talk about Chiron today a bit. And also, you know, human design this week is really lighting up a bunch of things. The evolutionary aspect of ourselves, the involutionary aspect of ourselves. And I think all of these things that we're experiencing, whether it's rebellion or anger or upset, being triggered, being, you know, told our work isn't good, or whatever, because no one ever actually said that, but that was my interpretation of it, makes us have to evolve,
yeah,
and grow, ascend,
mm-hmm,
right?
Yeah, yeah. And always, again, standing up for yourself, trusting it. It's your work. It's your creation. The people that you're collaborating with, the people that I'm collaborating with, mm-hmm, you know, and it's like, I have my finger on this and I know I can trust myself. And just because the other person doesn't know that about me, mm-hmm, right? It doesn't really know that about me. So, you know, I have to be the one to say, hey, you know, no, this is how it's going to be. This is how it's going to be.
Well, Debbie says she hasn't gotten angry though, just not sleeping. So, you know, literally, well, of course, last night it was a clear night here. So the moon, what kept me awake? I couldn't go to sleep because it was really bright in my room. But why is it that my thoughts can't be on all these positive, wonderful things? No, what am I thinking about? That edit, that thing I'm not getting done, that inability to move forward, the all of the triggered things are the ones that I'm thinking about.
Yeah. It's always the negative. We focus on the negative. I mean, it's like, you know, like think about this. So it's your birthday and you've got, you know, all these people that are wishing you happy birthday. And it's that one person that didn't wish you a happy birthday.
you focus on that.
And then you feel bad about that. It's kind of like that, right? It's like we focus on the negative. And our job right now is, mm-hmm, to transcend that energy, mm-hmm, to bring, you know, to transmute it, transcend it, and bring it up to into a higher vibrational way of living and being, and speaking the truth and being kind about it, being deliberate about it, being, you know, on purpose about it.
And being authentic.
Exactly.
Right. That when you and I were talking earlier this afternoon, or I guess it was this morning, who knows now, about what we were going to talk about today, you know, were very clear that you experience things and you can't be the only one, right? You're experiencing it. And as an ascension guide, it is your job then to bring it up, to bring it out, and then to not only move yourself through it, but also then working with other people to move through.
Yeah. And part of what I was feeling is, again, is moving into a deeper level of trust that we have to have. We have to, you know, demonstrate faith, that we have to demonstrate trust, because so many of us are going through so many changes. On the astrological scene, you know, what is it? Chiron moved into Aries, right? And that was palpable, that shift. You could really feel that.
Oh, I had people that next morning, they were like, one woman that had tuned in, she literally was fine one moment, and the next moment she was vomiting, and then got through that, and then she was fine the rest of the day. Not like she was sick. It just happened spontaneously. And, you know, that reminds me too, because, you know, the last degree of Pisces, which would be just before Chiron moved into Aries, was all about that trust, what level of trust, faith do we have in ourselves, in a benevolent universe, in other people, in things are moving in the right direction.
And guess what? What trust do we have? And when you're talking about Chiron moving into Aries, and Aries is Aries is ruled by Mars, mm-hmm, and Mars being in the old 3D world, being the god of war, and now in the 5D, it's not the god of war, it's the god of trust. And
I haven't heard that.
That's why I just made that up. God of trust just came out. So
I wonder, I haven't heard that yet.
Yeah, god of trust. So it's like and when you think about it, that's the action of faith that we have to live, because part of Chiron in Aries is healing our masculine energies, is healing that old masculine energy of the negativity, of going to war, of going to anger, of going into all of those places. It's healing that masculine energy. And when we look at the masculine energy of trust, like putting the cart before the horse, having faith and trust in the unseen. It is an action, like putting your money where your mouth is putting that action first. And that is, I'm going to act in trust. I'm going to act in faith. That's an action, yeah. Right? And so that's part of that energy. And it's not passive. It's taking action and putting that faith first, putting that trust first, and even in yourself, and especially in yourself, because that's where it begins.
Yeah, it is. And of course, the sign of Aries, the first sign of the zodiac, right. It rules the first house in your chart, which is the house of I am.
Right.
So what are we claiming for ourselves?
I am trust. Mm-hmm. I am love.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. I am honor, you know?
Right.
Whatever it is. I am worthy. I am love. I am.
Mm-hmm. So I'm accepted. I am. I mean, literally there's a plethora of words that we could put with the word self that are now being triggered in each one of us in terms of maybe seeing where you're not quite up to snuff. And then on the other side, you know, where are you, you know, very clear about who you are and your worthiness or whatever. And then, you know, on the other hand, maybe in the same, you know, next breath, where you aren't good enough. So we've got this going back and forth energy. And, you know, we've had heavyweights moving through Aries. We had Mars move through Aries just recently. We've had Uranus, which is still, you know, sitting at the very tottering at the last degree of Aries.
Yeah, right now.
Right now.
And wouldn't you say that that's the fire, that that's the electricity, that that's the rebellion?
Good one. Yes.
Huh?
Good one.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. So that's
at the karmic
rebellion,
degree, at
right?
The 29th degree.
Okay. So
there until March 6th.
So we're like acting out Uranus here. We're rebelling.
This is why I call it Uranus and not Uranus.
Oh, okay.
Or Uranus.
Yeah.
Let's be juvenile for just a minute.
Okay.
That's just funny.
Totally. I mean, we have to have a little bit of fun.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Let's see. Debbie says, maybe because I'm so empathic and feeling everyone's stuff, that is why she had moments of deep sadness off and on this past week and didn't know why. You know, Debbie, my husband and my daughter work at the same place. And there's a gentleman that they work with who very Uranus-like was struck. I mean, he's basically dead now. And I mean, I don't even know how to word it. He's brain dead, let's say. And I don't know why, but that took me down. And I hardly knew the guy. I mean, I knew who he was. I'd talked to him and that kind of thing, but I hardly knew him. But there was just something so random and unexpected in what happened to him that I really felt like, oh my God, is that like a call to action in our lives? You know, can it be that, you know, life, any moment, the lightning bolt can come down and strike you? And do I want to leave the planet with a bunch of regrets,
right?
A bunch of things I didn't get done? Or do I really, if it's my time, am I wanting to leave this planet with, what do they say, your hair on fire and I've done everything that I wanted to do?
Yeah.
So it's a huge sort of wake up call, but there was also this empathy that I was feeling.
Well, because we're all connected.
You
were feeling that. And then knowing that your husband and your daughter have a relationship and that it affects them.
Yeah.
And, you know, all these things. And then I think, you know, with this Virgo, the purity, I mean, like literally, like we're being asked right now to purify every single cell in our physical bodies, in our lives. Everything needs to be purified and made clean and, you know, mm-hmm. made whole. And so wherever it's not, it's going to stand out like a sore thumb to show us, hey, you know, this area needs more love. This area needs more kindness. This area needs more understanding.
Yeah.
This area needs more compassion. This area needs more truth. This area needs more trust. Right?
Definitely.
So
I always describe Virgo energy, like when Jupiter went through Virgo, it was a process of us finding all the pieces that of ourselves that were littered in the past, littered, you know, right here in this now that we haven't claimed, that we haven't made ourselves whole with. Even if it's a bad experience in the past, it's still a part of who you've been and who you are now, and is something that you need to, you know, come back to. or bring back to yourself in the interest of being whole. And realizing that even if you perpetrated something that on someone else that was hurtful, or that you yourself have been hurt, or any of the number of shadows you know, that we deal with, that it's all a part of your experience and it's all worthy of being brought in to one perfect whole.
Yeah.
Does that make sense to everybody? To you?
Yeah.
What I'm trying to say. So this full moon in Virgo was really highlighting to us perhaps the parts of ourselves that we haven't quite squared with.
Absolutely.
That we haven't been feeling really good about, or maybe it is the kind of clarion call about what comes next.
And I was feeling tremendous fears in the collective. Like there was different fears that were up, that it's like, wow, you know, all this uncertainty, all the, you know, there, it's almost like, you know, just this uncertainty. We really don't know what's going to happen. We can't really predict what's going to happen. It's like, we just have to be in this state of trust and love and honor and trust that these waves are going to, that we're going to ride these waves, that we're going to ride them and not be pushed over by them.
Right.
You know? So it's been an interesting, week. It's just been pretty intense, to say the least.
And I think people are probably, I know a woman on the morning show yesterday, she shared a dream that she had that was so powerful. She was in a cave, and I'm paraphrasing here. So Kathy, if you're listening, you can chime in and tell us if I've got this totally wrong. But in one part of the dream, she was moving through into a desert and there were all these snakes around her. And then in the very next scene, she was in the exact opposite environment. She was in the green of a jungle and then back into the cave and then out into the desert and back into the cave and then out into the jungle. And I went, wow, that is such a powerful, the snakes were the dead giveaway that we're talking about Chiron.
Yeah. And I mean, that's really what's happening on so many levels for all of us, because we're in so many different dimensions all the time as a multidimensional being, right? So there's so many things in the dream state, in the awake state, there's so many things that we're going through.
Yeah, tons. So when we look at human design, to me, always gives me this window, gene keys, maybe we could even say, because I like to go deeper. I like that contemplative search for what's of real meaning. And the sun and earth this week are in an interesting combination. One, the earth is at the gate 59, which is the most masculine gate. It is all about that fertile energy that goes out into the world and creates, right? We would think sometimes that the feminine is about the creative energy. Well, it is in some respects, but it's the masculine energy that actually takes it out into the world, that takes those steps.
Yep.
So the earth is sitting there challenging us to take steps. And
take steps in trust.
In trust, right? There is that too. And then the sun at gate 55 is about that intrinsic value that we have as human beings, right? That we don't have to go out and earn our value or our worth, that it comes with us, that there's this abundance through spirit.
Yeah.
And that energy is about our intrinsic value, and it's in the emotional center.
Yeah. And if you're reacting in ways to where you're not enough, where you're not whole, where you're still triggered, when you're still reacting that way, it has to be made neutral so that when you're acting from your true integrity, that is the abundance.
Well, you know, that is the one gate, gate 55. So if you guys have your human design charts out, gate 55 is on the emotional center. It is the gate that Richard Rudd refers to as our evolution, right? And its key word is freedom.
Love it.
And its highest expression in the world, once we get to that point, is freedom, like bigger freedom than the freedom of the gift, but it's freedom.
Yeah.
And then Mercury, our little messenger planet, sitting at gate 22, and gate 22 is the gate of involution. It is also on the emotional center. So
both of those.
Our involution and our evolution.
What does involution mean?
Evolution is the outer world changes, and involution is the inner world
so
changes.
Since Mercury is the communicator and it's also the divine masculine, I call Mercury the divine masculine, and I call Mars the divine masculine. I call both of them the divine masculine, communicator and also the action taker. So both are the divine masculine. Mm-hmm. And so since Mercury is on the involution right now, going retrograde in the shadow, right, is going inward. Mm-hmm. And so now we are looking at
how in Pisces,
how we're communicating in our water, how we're swimming
around.
Are
we sitting in our pity potty? Right? or are we swimming?
And are we loving ourselves inside? And are we communicating with ourselves on the inside, not from the negative standpoint of not enough, but from the positive standpoint, how lovely you are,
right.
how much you love yourself, how amazing you are, how gifted you are. Are those the thoughts that you're communicating to your inner water?
No. Sometimes.
Right. So that's the thing.
It's so fascinating to see, because this is where we are headed as a planet and as a solar system, as a universe, right? To that loving sort of energy that embraces all, right? That is whole. And we can see it right now this week in some of the things that are coming up for ourselves. We can see very clearly the things that we need to change, mm-hmm. or that we're, you know, working on. And Chiron, 7 years now, 6 years till 2026. That's 7 years.
Yeah.
In the sign of Aries, we are going to be working some powerful self-oriented energies for a while.
Which means we have to have confidence. We have to have healthy self-confidence, mm-hmm. right? We have to have healthy
self-acceptance.
Yeah. So mm-hmm. it's really going to be all about that. And wouldn't you call that, you know, the masculine energy, like where before the masculine energy went to war, and, you know, now it's really going to be like, no, we're going to confidently bring trust. We're going to confidently mm-hmm. bring self-acceptance. We're going to confidently bring those areas, right? Because the last, 8 or 9 years, it's been in, Chiron's been in Pisces, and we've had to heal the emotional
body.
With
Neptune.
Right?
Right, with Neptune.
I mean, we've literally had to, you know, we've cried our way through the vast ocean.
Felt our way, cried our way, yelled and screamed our way.
You know, the emotional body. And now what are we going to do for the next 8 years is really be confident. So I think everybody to have a powerful mantra that I accept myself, mm-hmm. I trust myself, I accept myself, I honor myself. And then how is that displayed in your actions? Like, what actions are you taking that shows that you do, so that you're putting your money where your mouth is? Like, you're going to press send on that email later. And that's how you're showing your self-confidence. That's how you're showing. And I'm going to have the conversation also. No, yes. You know, these are the ways, right? That right, how we're right. going to stand up and say, yeah, show that, you know.
Yes. But we also have to be very conscious of who we are as a collective as well, right? It's not okay to take this energy. I think you'll feel the wound very deeply if you take this energy and you make it selfish.
Yeah.
Or you make it all about you, right? That prima donna that I was feeling, you know, earlier, maybe that's, you know, making it all about you. Because it has to be nested within the other point, which is Libra, which is the we are.
That's the reason why it's kind of easy for me, because yes. it's a little bit easy for me because I've got the Aries rising and I've got the Libra sun.
She does.
You know, so it's a little bit on the seventh house.
It's a little bit easy
for me. It hasn't been, but this concept, because yeah. I'm always thinking of the other first and leaving myself out of the equation,
which is totally backwards. Yeah.
So now it's like, oh, okay, good. You know, now we can finally bring.
Look at this, Debbie. I had crazy dreams all week when I did sleep. Mm. Rebecca dreamt I was crucified and have felt this crisis energy since.
Oh, yeah.
Scary.
Yeah.
Patricia, oh, man, this is so spot on. I found my freedom today.
Yay!
By deciding to move from the city that I'm living in and back to my hometown. I've been so unhappy here for so long. Oh. And today I woke up and wrote my son and sister and friends and told them that I'm leaving here. My whole energy shifted and I'm so much happier even just knowing that I'm leaving and I'm free.
Good for you.
That's awesome, Patricia.
Totally.
That is so cool. We support you totally in that
Yeah. What a relief. I think sometimes when we make that kind of a decision, uh-huh. it's like we've been waiting to make the decision. And then when we make the decision, it's like, oh, good. Yeah, finally. And it's like, you know, starting a new life. I have somebody like that who recently made a decision, was living in Portland and then wanted to move to St. Louis Obispo.
Oh, San Luis Obispo.
Yeah.
Yeah. In California.
Yeah. And is just so happy there once she made the decision, you know? So, and it's just perfect. Sometimes we just have to make that move.
I have really fond memories of that town. When I was a kid growing up, there's a long lake right by there. Lake Nacimiento, I think is what it's called.
Oh, wow.
And oh, what a beautiful place. It is really a good energy there in that town.
That's what I hear.
Yeah. So Patricia, good on you, right?
Good on you.
You're doing it.
Good on everybody. Let's just put good and blessings and abundance on everybody. Let's put lots of love and compassion and healing on everybody.
It is done.
It is. Yeah.
So we have a half an hour still. What do we want to talk about next?
Who are you talking to?
You.
Okay. I think we should just keep going.
Okay.
We were in the flow.
What's next on the agenda?
Mm-hmm. We were talking a little bit about healing the masculine energies in all of us, right? Mm-hmm. I think that's a big theme moving forward with Chiron in Aries.
Mm-hmm. So I think I want to take up this energy of rebellion.
Okay.
Right. Not only because Chiron's in Aries, but because Mars just moved through Aries, because Uranus spent the last 7 years since 2011 in Aries. Right. So, So that energy of rebellion is very, it's there, right? We had how many movements, how many countries during that 7 years changed leadership from autocratic to, you know, different forms of democracy or, you know, self-rule. There were Occupy movements, the Occupy movement. I mean, whether or not these were successful or not, it doesn't really matter. It's that people were up in arms and they were on the move.
Yeah.
Right. There was this energy of this rebellion, no longer wanting the same, same old, same old. There's something to be said here about rebellion, but I want to call it mature rebellion or deliberate rebellion.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. Like, almost conscious.
Conscious. Oh, that's even better. I love that. Conscious rebellion, where we are purposefully setting out to upset and upend the old paradigm.
Yeah. Yeah.
And if we're going to consciously upend and upset the old paradigm, we have to have something to move to.
Mm-hmm.
That is what I think becomes revealed to us during this Chiron and Aries.
Wow.
Right. Where is it that we can pull up our big girl panties, pull up our boots, and really just, you know, empower ourselves to move toward that new paradigm?
Yeah. I mean, you know, the areas that you hold back, where you know, your pain points where you actually hold back or where you withdraw. If you can kind of strategize and know ahead of time, these are the areas where I don't speak up. These are the areas where I pull back. These are the areas and where you can consciously now say, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to do this.
Yes. But then you know what else? This just is random, but respecting what other people are going through as well.
Totally.
So, you know, you just shared the story before we were on air, she was talking about a fight at Walmart you witnessed between what was probably a husband and a wife or boyfriend and a girlfriend. And it was getting rather upsetting. And you thought, I can't let this go. I have to go make sure that she's okay. You cleared out the front seat of your car in case she needed a ride. And
I went there and I said, I rolled the window down and I said, can I give you a lift? Do you need a ride? And the woman just literally screamed at me and go, you know,
get nose out of my business.
Yeah. You know, no, I don't, you know, and just completely was just like standing up for the guy that who was totally in her face like this, you know? And I was like, wow. And okay, she doesn't want my help. So
trusting and letting go.
Right.
Yeah.
And I would imagine that we're going to have a lot of those, maybe not exactly like that moment, but moments like that where, you know, we're, especially like in the work that we're doing, and some of you guys out there are doing this kind of work too, where you're trying to bring along a group of people or your friends maybe, or people in your family, you're trying to uplift them and get them to see this pathway forward, and they're resistant, right? Or they don't want to hear. They're like, la, 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 la.
Yeah.
Right.
But that's that there's something about this and us as, you know, beings that are on the leading edge of ascension, we bring the energy of being the bridge. We bring the energy of curiosity and say, you know, let me try to understand what you're saying. So let me try to understand what you're saying. So yeah. Like, not just, you know, your way, but let me also try to understand, you know, what you're saying. And even though I may not agree with it, but I'll listen to what it is that you have to say.
Did you know that Chiron is considered the bridge, the rainbow bridge between the planet Saturn and the next one out, which is Uranus? So we consider Jupiter, Saturn to be the transpersonal planets, but they're, you know, on the inner side. And then Uranus, Neptune, Chiron, and Pluto, and anything else out there, Ceres, and they're all the outer planets.
I have a confession to make.
What?
I think that I'm in love with Chiron. I think I love Chiron. I really do. I think, you know, I've gotten so intimate with Chiron. It's like, seriously, I think I'm in love with him.
You need to, have you watched Hercules? I mean, no. Come on, you've got Liam. Liam, is that his name? Robin's son?
Leaf.
I mean, he's got to have that movie, Hercules, where Chiron makes an appearance in Hercules.
Okay.
As the healer.
Yeah. But what is Chiron is half man, half horse, right?
Correct.
So there you go. You know, I feel like I'm in love with Chiron. I mean, because think about it. It's, you know, the emotional body, my work, you know, everything I've been doing over the last how many years is really getting, you know, clearing the emotional body and, you know, healing the wounds of our past so that we can move back into a state of being neutral. Not that we don't, but again, it's coming from that truth, from that abundant place, from that neutral place, right?
Coming from neutral. So hard. Neutral. Shift down. So yes, Chiron, the very first book that ever came to me about astrology was Chiron.
Wow.
It was Barbara Henclow's book.
Oh,
Chiron,
I love her.
Rainbow Bridge.
Yeah.
Between the inner and outer planets or something like that.
Yeah.
And I mean, she makes the case. She's probably one of the first people that did that Chiron, you know, erupting into our consciousness in 1978 really kind of was the harbinger of the inner work that we were going to have to do.
Yeah.
Right. Up until that time, there was, you know.
No, up until that time, everything was kind of easy. We were like, those were the days, the simple days, you know, where we weren't quite as awake.
We didn't question.
We didn't. No, we
our
certainly.
Our roles, we didn't question
our
who
consciousness,
we were.
Certainly. Yeah. You know, we were like, you know, can walk around unconscious and it's okay. Right. Yeah.
But I was only 16. You were less than that. So, you know, it didn't. But I distinctly remember what it was that triggered my Chiron. And although at that time, I didn't know that's what it was. So for every one of you, you can backtrack. I mean, if you're younger than if you were not around in 1978, you were born already with this consciousness of with a wound and healing. But for those of us that were born before 1978, you know, my life seemed fairly idyllic until 1978.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, maybe not perfect. I had lots going on, but
yeah,
it didn't dawn on me that those were the sources of any pain that I was experiencing in my daily life.
Yeah. But just like, you know, we were talking about like right now, these next 8 years, Chiron and Aries, I think that those are the places we really need to pay attention to really have those mantras of self-empowerment, self-acceptance, confidence, healthy self-esteem. It's all the places where we take healthy action, right action.
Yeah. Angie's asking a really good question. Why is Chiron called the wounded healer? And she says, oh my God, my channel from Saturn included the rainbow bridge. Makes so much sense, right? Angie, perfect.
Yeah.
And anyway, the reason why Chiron is called the wounded healer, because the mythology of Chiron is that he was a demigod. He was part mortal and part divine. And when he was wounded, he begged the gods to allow him to die because it was so pained and it hurt. And he was told, no, you're of divineness. So you don't get to die and move on. You're going to have to stay here and deal with it. And on top of that, find the healing path forward. And there are many different Chiron stories. And Chiron is also sometimes shows up as Asclepius. I don't know how to say it exactly, but essentially the healer that, you know, is a serpent. He is the master of the serpents. And that's how the snake ends up coming to represent healing and even gets intertwined with the medical profession as it is now with the caduceus and the intertwining snakes. And it really, if you look even in the star maps or the constellation maps, you know, I have this really cool app on my phone, Star 3D. You can look it up and you can see Ophiuchus, which is Chiron, which is Asclepius, Asclepius. And the three of them all represent this pathway to healing from a wound, from a trigger, from something that's happened, is you then consciously creating a pathway forward to heal.
Yeah.
And then from there, you end up usually after your 50th birthday, because that's when you have your Chiron return, is then you become the healer, and the people that you see in your outer world end up being the ones that are experiencing what you might have had to heal yourself through. And you could then become the coach, the guide, the, you know, counselor, the whatever you want, you know, the healer.
Yeah.
So it's a path. It's an archetype.
Yeah, it is. And the point is that we're all, you know, affected by the wounded healer, because we all are healing our wounds from our past. Right. And we all have felt it was so painful that we wanted to die, that we didn't want to be here anymore.
There's also something else that is interesting about all of that from an astrological standpoint. So I'm going to say it. And if you are in this group of people, don't take it personally, but there was an entire generation. We call them the baby boomers. I refuse to believe I'm a baby boomer, by the way. I think I'm really more Generation X in the way I look at things. But those baby boomers, or the people who were born with Pluto in Leo, they really started to really like lay the blame on their childhoods. That's where a lot of inner child work sprung up, right? They looked to their childhood and it was their parents' fault, or the things their parents didn't give to them, the love they didn't receive or whatever. So they go through the psychological development of the inner child. But what that ends up kind of leading to is Chiron's discovery, right, in the 70s. And now you have to take personal responsibility. Yes, so what? That happened to you, right? Almost everybody in this country in some way, shape, or form has been sexually abused, sexually assaulted.
Me too.
Abandoned.
Me too.
Me too. Has been, you know, somehow wounded. And instead of then laying the blame at the foot of your parents or society or whatever, it was about beginning the process of consciously creating healing from within.
Yeah. I mean, that was actually when it shifted for me back in the day when I said, when I pulled the energy off of my mom and said, you know, I'm not going to point my finger to you anymore. I'm putting it right here because I chose you.
And that's because the Pluto in Virgo generation set the template for healing.
Yeah.
For holistically living. And this is a very broad description. So I mean, if you're out there and you were born with Pluto and Leo, don't get dismayed. That's, you know, you did your work,
right?
That was your work, was that inner child recognizing that there is something immature within us that we hold on to, that we take with us into adulthood. Mm-hmm. And then we make decisions and take actions based on that.
Yeah.
So then Chiron bursts into the play here and, you know, changes the game.
Yeah.
Right.
So, yeah.
And, you know, think about it. What was it? 1966, 65, 66 and 67, I think, were where Pluto and Uranus were in conjunction. It was the beginning of the civil rights, you know, the whole explosion of, you know, that wound of slavery really coming up and, you know, facing us in, you know, how it is we treat one another from a civil rights standpoint, women, you know, it was like this next, like all these things, these ingredients were coming together. And then Chiron sort of forcing us now to take responsibility for that. And we are really in a really good place here because Chiron and Aries, this is now the first time in our consciousness of Chiron that we have Aries energy at our fingertips, which is about the new.
Which is about the I am, which is about the I am it's new.
To, yeah,
which,
it's about being responsible for self. I mean, we're going to deal with all kinds of self-related issues. We'll probably deal with people who are trying to be too dependent versus people who are trying to be too independent. And we have to learn the interdependence.
I think one way for people to really find out is to watch and see how they're being treated in their inner circle.
That's a good one.
That's a great way is that however you're being treated, you know, like, are you being too clingy? Are you being, you know, how are the mirrors?
Yes.
How are the mirrors showing? Because then you can see where the work still needs to be done on the inside.
Yes.
You know,
my one daughter, Jennifer, she's also like you, right? Rising sign in Aries. And that girl, I mean, from the moment she was born, she was going to do things her way. And it was going to be, you know, I'm going to tie my shoes. I don't need your help. You know, in the end, it ends up being devastating if you can't reach out when you need help.
Yeah.
Right. And she, for the longest time, had migraines, and migraines would be a symptom of Aries gone wrong. And, you know, part of that tension and stress is about not reaching out when you need help.
Yeah.
Right. Not realizing that you don't have to go it alone.
Oh yeah.
So they're going to be the people that are in that. Then there's going to be the people at the other end that can't take responsibility or haven't up until this point been able to take responsibility for their own selves. So that's going to be big in the world as well.
Well, and the thing about it is we're really not supposed to at this stage of the game do things on our own anymore as far as you know doing things alone. Hence you and I doing this show together. You know, it's nice to do, you know, to have your own thing going on, but the collaboration, because it with our collaboration and how we show up for each other, how we honor each other, how we support each other, that is how we're, you know, laying down the grid in the new earth. You know,
Tom wants to know if you're a generator.
If who's a generator?
You.
Yep.
We're both generators. She's a provocateur generator. I like to tell her that.
Yeah.
She pokes.
Hopefully I poke in a good way.
Yes. Yeah. Oh yeah. Provoke is
provoking people into the abundance of their spirit.
I love that.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I brought this today because we were going to talk a little bit about abundance.
We did, right? A little bit. Gate 55 is the abundance through spirit.
So I love this quote by Rick Jarrow, and he calls it the alchemy of abundance. The way of abundance is all too often misconstrued as a shallow sense of getting what one wants, eliminating the negative, or being free from pain. Even the often touted manifestations of your dreams offers a psychological disposition that generally remains fixated around manifestation as the project of me. But the project of me can never be enough, for it does not meet the other. And real living involves meeting. The touch and contact with all of life, the full freedom of non-separation, and the radiance of compassionate ecstasy is what we are inherently hungry for.
Ooh,
isn't that beautiful?
Good stuff. Good stuff.
Yeah.
That's from the book, maybe, The Alchemy of Abundance. Is that the book?
I think so. I think so. Yeah. But pulled that
good
up.
Stuff.
Yeah.
So Tom, just to make it clear, she has a defined throat, so she can speak. He said, if you're a generator, then you needed to wait for an invitation. And I said, the reason I was saying that is because literally she can speak.
The thing about it is that I, you know, this is, and here's my Aries rising. And I, you know, I take all systems with a grain of salt. You know, like,
oh yeah,
every system is designed, but it doesn't mean that I follow it to a T, because if I waited if I waited for everything to before I was invited, then that's not my way. It's not your design.
Either.
It's not my design because I'm an initiator.
You're not an.
I do initiate things. Mm-hmm. I do.
Mm-hmm. I do. Hopefully, only in response because you're not a manifester.
No, but I do initiate things because I am an Aries rising. And I also begin things, you know, so that's what I also do. I don't necessarily 100% buy into this thing about this is what I have to do as far as being a generator. I don't buy into it.
Wow. Oh, wow. I'm going to be blinded by the sun.
Let me get the.
She's going to close that blind. Wow. Sunset here. Woo, thank you. Amazingly, before I left this afternoon, I actually had to close the drapes in my kitchen because I was trying to unload the dishwasher and I looked up and I mean, I literally got blinded for the moment because the sun was so bright.
It's about time that we had the sun out.
Yes.
Great.
Sunshine on my shoulders. I love it. Let's see. Projector needs to wait. Is that not correct? It is true. Projectors are waiting for the invitation. Generators only need to respond. They're waiting just to respond to what shows up in their outer world. So if an opportunity shows up in the outer world for them to do, then they just next run it through whatever their emotional spleen.
She bit your head off.
I felt like that was why she bit your head off when you were just asking if she may need help. This is the lady on the bench.
Oh.
Yeah. That said, you know, mind your own business kind of thing.
I mean, her boyfriend looked like he was about to punch her in the face. And I certainly wouldn't wait to be invited.
No. Yeah.
You know, you have to override.
There's societal things that we adhere to that if you see somebody being punched in the gut, you're not going to wait for their invitation to say, I need your help. No. This is about the big things in life, Tom. So when we're talking about needing an invitation or we're talking about responding, it is about taking action on something. And for a projector, for example, to just go out and start pushing themselves into relationships could be a disaster. They need to be invited in because otherwise they waste a lot of energy, and end up burned out. So we do things by an invitation. If we're a projector, Tom is a generator. So a generator with an open throat. And I think that's maybe what you're thinking of when it comes to her walking to the bench or going over to the bench and talking to the lady, because a person with an open throat needs to wait for the invitation to begin speaking. And they are invited into the conversation. So you could say that is an issue here, but it's not the big thing in life, whether you're going to go to a bench and talk to somebody about whether they need help.
Mm-hmm.
I hope that is how you can distinguish the difference there. So,
yeah.
And Kornelia has a defined throat. So
what does that mean?
You're designed to speak.
Okay.
So it works better if you wait to be asked to speak or enter a conversation, but it's different for someone with a defined throat. Mm. You can just go out and start the conversation and people recognize you for it. Where an open throat has to kind of question or, you know, wait for someone to say, hey, I want to know what she thinks about this.
Okay. Right? Gotcha. Yeah.
So there are fine lines, there are distinctions here. And what you did with this woman was not really something I would have done it even with an open throat.
Yeah.
If I saw somebody that was being hurt or possibly needed, you know, saving in some way.
Well, it was out in broad daylight and, you know,
what is that? I mean, an invite would also be her crying help. Yep. That's true too. But again, it's the big things in life. It's the personal things that you're getting ready to take action on that you use your human design type and strategy for. It isn't whether you don't evaluate whether you're going to help somebody that looks like they're getting ready to be punched by their boyfriend, based on your human design. Right? That you just jump. If it was a child, you know, you're not going to wait for the child to say, oh, please save me from this bus that's about to hit me. You're going to act. So it's common sense, right? The common sense things that we live day to day, we can take action on, but big things, right? If you're going to spend a lot of money, if you're going to spend a lot of time on something, if you're going to get involved in a relationship, if you're going to go to work, if you're going to quit a job, if you're going to quit a relationship, those are big things. If you're going to move cross country, those are the things that you follow your type and your strategy for. Mm. Hope that helps. Okay. What else? We've got 6 minutes.
Wow.
Didn't I just say 30 minutes?
Yeah. It went by quick.
Dang.
It's amazing.
Yeah. So, hi, Susan. Me too. Lovelies. Nice to see you out there. Tom, what is this? Oh, wounded healer. crystallinks.com/woundedhealer. Might be some explanation more about the wounded healer. There are, you know, by the way, more than just the one myth around Chiron, but they are all about wounding and healing. Some of them have him wounded in a different way. Some of them actually take the step and go into the spiritual realm with this. And it just depends on whether you're talking Greek or Roman or what story, what myth we're dealing with. So,
yeah.
You know, it would be interesting to see if there were characters like that in, say, Norse mythology or in the Mayan mythologies or Chinese mythologies. I bet they all have a character that represents that wound.
Yeah.
Because it can't just be, you know, just certain.
All I know is that I'm looking forward to these next 8 years to see how this is going to be played out in Aries.
Yeah.
I am looking so forward to this because I know that the last 8 years have been extremely painful.
Yeah.
You know, and, but we as a humanity, we have definitely gone through so much in our evolution. And really, I mean, we didn't just heal this lifetime. We've healed all our lifetimes.
Right.
Which is, it's been so huge, you know, so,
yeah.
It's been huge.
And there are big, big things happening from an astrological standpoint. As I was reading you that letter earlier, you know, one of the things that I was pointing to is, you know, in this next year, I'm already working on the almanac for 2020. So I was already into this next year. We'll be experiencing something that we haven't experienced in almost 4,000 years. And that is Jupiter and Pluto and Saturn conjunct in Capricorn.
Wow.
Literally, the last time that happened was 1894 BCE. So before Christ. And that makes it about almost 4,000 years ago now, maybe 39, I don't know, some long time ago, right? A long time ago. And it was interesting because at that point in time, it was the birth of Babylonia, of Babylon.
Wow.
Right. So you're going way back in time. Within 100 years of that point in time, there were the codes of Hammurabi, which were the first laws that were governing civilization. So what we are seeing then for ourselves here is the rearranging of the paradigm of the laws that we have held sacrosanct for 4,000 years.
Yeah. And now we're making up new ones.
Or devising them so
that they work for us in an organic way now.
In a new paradigm way.
Exactly.
Yeah. In an ascended sort of way.
Which is really important that you stand in your integrity and that you speak your truth. And that you, right, that you are your own authority, right? Because otherwise you're going to be listening to what somebody else is talking about.
But in a very real way, there's a lot changing. I don't know that it'll be in our lifetimes where we see laws that are changing. I don't know. Things also seem to be sped up.
Yeah.
So what took 4,000 years to come to a point of deconstruction, you know, changing the laws, changing the paradigm, for us now may, you know, be 10 years, 3 years, 5 years, you know,
who knows? I mean, geez,
things can change like in this moment.
Yeah.
So by the time we get to January and, you know, at the time Babylon was established, or Babylonia, the planets only came together one time in 2020. They are together for the whole year off and on.
Wow.
Right. As one retrogrades, it moves back into it. As another one goes forward, it moves forward into it. And off and on for the whole of the year, we are in this change around laws and the way things have been, the established order being undone. Redone? Reestablished?
Well, we are building a new earth.
Broken down and
makes
put together?
Yeah.
rebuilt.
Yeah, yeah, at least we're not wounded.
Well, that's the why. That's the why it's so important for us each to do our own work in this wound, because if we see a world that's in chaos and disintegrating in front of us, as laws change and as structures and forms change, and we are personally hurt by these things, and we're not doing our own healing work, we may literally just go insane with all of the energies that are happening.
Yeah.
It's been hard for a lot of people to stay on that solid level ground.
Which is why the emotional work is the key. Mm-hmm. It's absolutely the key into your own liberation, the emotional work.
Patricia hits it here. She says, it seems that the system is being challenged and I think will likely dissolve and be replaced by organic systems.
Nice.
Yeah. There's something to be said about the understanding of how all things come together and nest within one another and are dependent upon one another. Interdependency being the key word that Chiron, I think, will ultimately be leading us to. Right? We can't keep destroying the earth and expect that we're going to be able to have life on this planet.
Yeah. I mean, can you imagine? I mean, just the snow this year, that it snowed in Florida, it snowed in Las Vegas, and it snowed in Hawaii.
Yes. I saw that video on Facebook.
Yeah.
Of snow in Hawaii.
So that, like, wow. that tells us.
Yeah. So things are in flux, things are in change, but do your own work. That's going to save you. That is going to, not that you need saving, by the way, that's not what I mean at all, but it's going to keep you sane during these coming challenging times. And that's all I have to say today. We're at 5 o'clock already.
Awesome. Wonderful show.
Yes. Wonderful show. Thank you for letting us be here in your
environment. Wonderful.
It's beautiful here. We'll see you all next week. For those of you who are part of my Living Astrology group, I will be on air tomorrow morning, 8 a.m., where we are going to be looking at the weekend.
Yay.
So anyway, have a good evening, everybody. Take care. And we hope we've given you lots of things to think about and to take in with your heart.
Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Yay. Subscribe.
I actually put that link in the write-up for this today. So subscribe, hit like, talk to us, do something. And oh yeah, we're still working on prizes and gifts and things like that.
Yep. We're going to do it.
We are.
Yep.
All right. Okay. Bye everybody. Take care.
Bye.